Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here, and I thank the organizers and the association for having invited me for this talk. I think we are switching gears from some excellent videos that we saw on some complex thoracic, esophageal, and gastric procedures to something which is probably a little more boring, which is the evidence with multimodality treatment of esophageal cancer. Not all of us can operate the way these experts just showed us, but I think all of us can definitely make decisions the way they need to be done. And what I hope to do over the next 14 to 15 minutes is to cover these points. Very briefly on the background, what would be the optimum treatment for localized esophageal cancer, some of the controversies, the evidence to support or to refute that, and some of our own data from the Tata Memorial Center. We all know that esophageal cancer is a morbid disease with a poor prognosis. Till about a couple of, till about a decade back, it was associated with approximately 25% survival, even with complete resection. We know that non-surgical treatment has really not lived up to its promise. The results are far inferior compared to surgical treatment. But unfortunately, surgery has also been associated with considerable morbidity and mortality. So the question arises, with these kind of dismal background to support this, whether some kind of either neoadjuvant or adjuvant treatment could help improve outcomes in these patients. There are intuitively appealing theoretical reasons why neoadjuvant and adjuvant treatment could work, especially with neoadjuvant treatment. The micrometastasis are treated early. The treatment is delivered when the blood supply is intact, which is not the case when adjuvant treatment is given. It downstages tumors, and most people who have operated after neoadjuvant treatment realize that the R0 resection rates are far better when you operate with after neoadjuvant treatment. And it's been shown that when you give chemotherapy with radiation, they act synergistically, and the sum of these two is actually more than what each of them can do individually. However, it can also increase the morbidity and mortality of surgery. There are technical difficulties of operating in a pretreated field. There might be problems with anastomotic healing. The pulmonary complications could be higher, and probably these are the reasons why multimodality treatment in esophageal cancer was a bit late to take off in the Indian context. The treatment itself can cause death. There have been reports of a very small percentage of patients actually dying of the pre-operative neoadjuvant treatment itself. So these are issues to be considered when we make a decision. So what I'll do is to try and summarize the evidence that we have. With neoadjuvant chemotherapy, the first of the large trials was this large intergroup trial from the US, which randomized close to over 400 patients, and unfortunately showed absolutely no difference in survival between patients who got neoadjuvant treatment and those who were treated with surgery alone. And just a few years later came this much larger study from the UK, which was a Medical Research Council cooperative group study, which randomized 800 patients to either neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery or surgery alone. This was conducted in over 150 centers in the UK. A lot of people criticized this study on the grounds that 800 patients, 150 centers, over 7 years, the average is about one patient per center per year, which is pretty low. But I would actually consider this as a strength of the study in the sense that it mimics a real-life scenario rather than the artificial environment of a randomized trial. And what this study showed that there was that there was a significant improvement in survival when neoadjuvant treatment was given. So unfortunately, two large trials, well-conducted trials, going in opposite directions, one showing no difference, and the other showing a significantly improved outcome. So a meta-analysis was done in 2007, which included over 10 randomized trials which looked at neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And what it showed was that there was a significant improvement in survival when neoadjuvant treatment, neoadjuvant chemotherapy was given. But this meta-analysis also looked at neoadjuvant chemo radiation as compared to surgery alone. And you can see that the evidence is equally strong, if not even more stronger than just chemotherapy alone. And this has created one of the biggest controversies in the management of esophageal cancer. The controversy is no longer whether we should give neoadjuvant treatment. In my view, it's only whether it should be chemotherapy or chemoradiation. Very briefly on adenocarcinomas, there are two very well-conducted trials, but unfortunately these used patients both from the esophagus and the lower esophagus as well as from the stomach. And what you see is the first intergroup trial, which was reported in 2001, which showed that there was a 3-year survival benefit when adjuvant treatment in the form of radical chemo radiation was given to completely resected patients with GE junction and gastric tumors. The survival benefit was 9% at 3 years and a median survival benefit of 9 months. However, this was associated with considerable toxicity, and out of these patients who were randomized in this trial, 70% of them had grade 3 or grade 4 toxicity, which is considerable, and probably even in the US setting, if you try to extrapolate these results to the Indian setting, these may not actually be equally viable. So the next trial which came out was the MAGIC trial, again a very pragmatic trial which came out from the UK, which randomized patients to perioperative chemotherapy alone, 3 cycles of ECF preoperatively, surgery, and 3 cycles postoperatively compared to surgery alone. And what this showed was an equally good, if not better, survival benefit than what was seen with the McDonnell trial. A 5-year survival benefit of 13%, which was something unheard of in GE junction tumors and gastric cancers. So clearly, a very good benefit with something which is much better tolerated with just preoperative and postoperative chemotherapy as compared to surgery alone. So the next question is, is this form of neoadjuvant therapy safe? And what we saw is, and the next question that comes also is whether it should be chemotherapy and chemoradiation. I think these are interlinked questions. And what you saw from this meta-analysis of the morbidity and mortality of neoadjuvant treatment was that when you looked at chemotherapy alone, when you looked at chemoradiation, what you actually saw was that the mortality was much higher in patients who underwent chemoradiation followed by surgery as compared to surgery alone. But when you look at the chemotherapy alone, you see that they are absolutely the same. The mortality results were identical. The results of these meta-analysis was actually reiterated by a more recent meta-analysis, which is close to 4,000 patients, which compared both neoadjuvant chemotherapy and chemoradiation. The results are practically the same as with the previous meta-analysis, superior results with chemotherapy followed by surgery as compared to surgery alone, and again, superior results with chemoradiation followed by surgery as compared to surgery alone. However, again, the mortality results were exactly the same, and this is with a larger patient subset. Postoperative mortality was 1.6 times in chemo radiation as compared to surgery, whereas it was identical when it was confined to neoadjuvant chemotherapy alone. So what you might argue about which of these two strategies is better, but this graph shows us everything lower to the horizontal line are the trials which have shown a benefit with neoadjuvant treatment, and the ones above the horizontal line are the ones which have shown no benefit. And to anyone in this audience, there cannot be any doubt that neoadjuvant treatment followed by surgery is the standard of care, even if the patient has a resectable esophageal cancer. I'll very briefly end this with some of our own experience, but this is important. A lot of the arguments I see against neoadjuvant treatment is that this cannot be tolerated by our patients. Our patients are different from Western patients. They are frailer. They are more malnourished, so they may not be able to tolerate it. So we have a large experience of patients, almost a 10-year experience with a prospective database almost to the date. We started this database on the 1st of October 2003. It's exactly 10 years now. We have close to 1,700 patients operated over this 10-year period. We have a heavy bias towards a transthoracic esophagectomy, and we reserve a transhiatal esophagectomy only in patients who are unfit for a thoracotomy or with extensive pulmonary fibrosis. We are currently running a randomized trial, which is comparing two-field to three-field, but we still have a much larger experience with a two-field lymphadenectomy. We do a fair share of video-assisted thoracoscopic and laparoscopic esophagectomy as well. And as you see, what we had in 2003 was that 1/4 of our patients used to get neoadjuvant treatment. But with growing confidence with both the morbidity and the results of surgery, our current neoadjuvant treatment rate is 92%. The only patients who don't get neoadjuvant treatment in our setting now are patients who are unfit for multimodality treatment, which is a very small percentage. As you can see, it's 8% of patients who undergo surgery. Or if the patient has very early disease, if it is T1, T2, N0, confirmed on an endoscopic ultrasound. This has also been paralleled with our increasing use of video-assisted thoracoscopic esophagectomy, which has probably helped us reduce the morbidity of this quite formidable procedure. And we looked at the data which compared neoadjuvant chemotherapy, chemoradiation, and surgery alone. And what you can see is that the complication rates are more or less similar. If you look at the pulmonary complication rates, they are 28% with surgery alone, 25% with Neogen chemotherapy and 32% with chemoradiation. Our experience with chemoradiation followed by surgery is quite modest. It's just 40 patients. And these are, again, part of a randomized trial that we are currently conducting to compare Neogen chemotherapy with chemoradiation. Anastomotic leak rates, almost similar with surgery and with chemotherapy. However, it's slightly higher with chemoradiation, and this is probably because in middle third lesions, the fields of radiation actually include the anastomotic site. The overall major morbidity, again, quite comparable between the three groups, marginally higher with chemoradiation, but with chemotherapy and surgery, it's almost the same. ICU median stay 1 day, and it's actually come down to zero as in the last couple of years. Hospital stay was 11 over the entire study period, but it's right now at 9 days. The overall mortality, marginally higher with surgery alone, but I think this is a bit of a selection bias. The patients who are not fit for multimodality treatment are the ones who are considered for surgery, and these are probably sicker patients than those treated with chemotherapy or chemoradiation. But you can see that the chemotherapy and chemoradiation certainly don't add to the mortality. That's something that's come across very clearly. To summarize, I think we've had enough data to show that esophageal surgery is safe and it offers the best chance for cure. Neogen treatment followed by surgery is the optimum treatment. I don't think we have any doubts about that. There is both a survival benefit that has been proven by multiple randomized trials as well as a large meta-analysis. We've shown that in our own patients, it is safe and it is tolerable. And I think in this age, surgery alone as treatment for esophageal cancer, unless it is very early esophageal cancer, is no longer justified. And I'll take this opportunity with the permission of the organizers to invite you for this surgical workshop at the Tata Memorial Center from the 15th to the 17th, which will cover all aspects of surgical oncology, right from head and neck, GI, thoracic, soft tissue, breast, and so on. And I'll also take this opportunity to invite you to become members of the newly formed Indian Society for Diseases of the Esophagus and Stomach. I thank you very much for your attention, and I'll be glad to take any questions if you have any.